break at 4 o'clock and my watch might be... If you wouldn't mind, please. I make it 4 o'clock, we're going to start. I can start by saying this is a special meeting of the Standards and Constitution Oversight Committee. The purpose of it is to look at the findings of the Standards Panel, which was held on the 15th of June. And the decisions that came from that panel, also things that have happened since then. Can I just check? I know Councillor Demetri Jones will be quite present. You also understand that the signers are not able to get here until 6 o'clock. Can I ask, are you happy to go ahead with the meeting without the signers being present? Or would you like us to adjourn until 6 o'clock, which we're happy to do?
I'm happy to go ahead. I thought my main views gonna be my ears if I miss anything. I'd ask if that was okay.
That's fine. And are you comfortable with the arrangements that there are in the room for you to understand what's happening? Yeah, good. Okay. I think it might be helpful if we just do a quick round of introductions. We've got conscious that we've got quite a few members of the public here, and it will be helpful, I'm sure, for them if they understand who everybody is. I'll start with you, if you don't mind, Professor.
Ronald Jones, independent person.
Brian.
Brian Kenny, the Council of the Business and Gender Board, Phil Davis, Rockford and Ransom.
Bernie Mooney, Council of the First Parts, and Standing for Ron.
Paul Stewart, Council of the Sea.
I'm Councillor Moira McLaughlin, I'm Labour Councillor and Chair of this committee.
I'm Philip McCourt, I'm the Monitoring Officer.
I'm Councillor Chris Blakely, Assistant Councillor for North West and Silver Massey, and Conservative Spokesman on this committee.
I'm Councillor Jerry Ellis, Councillor for Wallasey and Mills.
Paul Hayes, Councillor for Wallasey.
Phil Gilchrist, Councillor for Eastham and member of the Standards Panel.
Thank you very much, everybody. Can I start by asking, are there any apologies for absence? I know we've got Ron Abbey, and we've got... thank you. We've got Bernie Mooney in attendance in place of Ron Abbey. John Hale, and that's Paul. Okay. And can I ask members to give me an undertaking that they have, if they've got any declarations of interest? On this, yes, Paul?
Yeah, to make a non-pecuniary declaration of interest that I'm the subject member of our standards in fact.
Okay. Anybody else?
So was I. I was present at the meeting with the chair's manager.
Okay, so you want to declare that? Okay. Okay, so now I'm going to just draw attention of members to the pack they have in front of them, the public pack. In that, you've got several reports. The first one we'll hear from the Interim Director of Law at the moment, and he'll talk us through his report. But you've also got a number of other reports. One is the Independent Investigations Report that was presented to the Standards Panel on the 15th of June. You've got the decision letter, which was produced by panel members as a result of that panel hearing, and you've also got a follow-up report by Vicky Shaw on circumstances that have arisen since then. So I'm going to ask Director of Law if you'd like to talk us through your report, please.
Thank you, Chair. And for the benefit of the members of the public, the process for this afternoon is that this report will be presented and the members will be entitled to ask us questions on that. And then the Chair has stated that she will invite anyone affected by this matter, the complainants, to make a short statement to the committee. There won't be any questions because this isn't an investigatory panel or committee. And then finally, Councillor Louise Jones, to provide that element of fairness, will have the last say in terms of her presentation to the committee, and then the committee will debate what happens next. So, Chairman members, you have a covering report from me, which goes through the elements that I was asked to report on to you today. Essentially, that is to bring before the full public committee the outcome of the standards panel in June. That's not to go through it all again, but simply to say there was a full hearing. That hearing was on the back of an independent investigator appointed by the council, a former marching officer of the London Bar and lawyer, and behind that, an originating internal audit report. It's then down to me to report to you what has happened since then, because the panel asked for a number of things to happen. First of all, it was to report that decision to you. It's then to the panel asked for a number of people to do a number of things. Principally, it was to ask the Labour group to consider what action it should take in response to the findings of the panel, because, as you know, the sanctions that any standards committee can give anymore are not there. The committee and the authority can ask for a number of actions to take place, but all of those are short of the powers that you used to have in terms of suspension or removal from a committee or anything like that. Those are matters for a political party and indeed the electorate when it comes around to the ballot box. So you asked the Labour group to consider your finding. There is an appendix at item C which reports to you that the Labour group suspended Councillor Rhys Jones. That was subject to appeal, and the regional Labour Party have decided that suspension from the political group would be for 4 months. Now, that's a matter for the party and is entirely independent of anything this authority or you as members can do, but that was something you asked of them, and that's something they considered and responded. Principally, for me, it was to report back on the actions of Councillor Rhys Jones in terms of what you asked her to do, and that was to make a full apology to the persons who made the complaint, who were subject to her actions in breach of the Code of Conduct. Councillor Rhys Jones sought, under your procedures, to appeal the panel's decision. That's within the gift of the monitoring officer to consider whether there are sufficient grounds for an appeal at the second hearing. Mr. Tor considered those appeal grounds. There was a number of them, and he considered that there weren't sufficient grounds to move ahead to hold an appeal. So at that point, the actions that you asked of Councillor Rhys Jones kicked in, and your time limit of 14 days within which an apology should be made also kicked in. Councillor Rhys Jones and I, since then, have exchanged several pieces of correspondence in terms of both that and also the requirement that you placed upon ourselves to provide training, Councillor Rhys Jones. It came to a point where and you may wish to comment on this, but I considered that as no apology had been made, but indeed a pushback of appeal and counter-allegations being made, that frankly training and arranging of training would be a waste of everybody's time until we got to that point of an apology being made. So I haven't made formal arrangement for training. I simply asked Councillor Rhys Jones when she would be available for training. The result of that correspondence was that on the 18th of October I received some what I might call draft letters of apology directly to me. They were without address but named to the complainants, and I've given you an example of one of them. The others had a statement with them that they were private and not for publication, so I haven't published them. But I did reply and say that I would imagine that you as a committee would find that not a suitable apology. And I would like to see evidence that they've been sent, because I don't consider sending unaddressed letters to me to pass on. That was appropriate, and it wasn't something I was going to do. It was for Councillor Rhys Jones to make the apology and send them, not ourselves. The outcome from that is Councillor Rhys Jones wrote and stated that she was unsure what she would like me to write in the apology, because the panel made it clear I was to apologise for breaching the code of conduct. This is additional to the undeserved apology I gave you in the standards here. My response, as this was the 27th of October, was that at this late stage I would suggest that further guidance on what the panel considered should be in an apology is a matter for the committee meeting today, so that's something you may wish to address your mind, Mr. Chair. The next element is that the panel asked for a review of some of the comments that the independent investigator made before the panel in terms of Councillor Rhys Jones' cooperation with her investigation and her ability to be a reliable witness with a consistent story. We asked for a further look at that as a separate matter you may wish to consider. Shortly afterwards, there was also a further complaint made by two of the original complainants that Councillor Rhys Jones' behaviour had continued in the same vein, and social media postings had been made simply repeating that she was the one being harassed and that she was the one who was subject to false allegations. The decision of Mr. Tor, who looked at that, was that rather than start a process all over again on investigation and the panel, actually that's part of the review. And so rather than a full investigation, a review was requested. Mrs. Shaw was appointed as the relevant group solicitor with experience in both litigation and safeguarding over many years to look at that, who interviewed the complainants and interviewed Councillor Rhys Jones. Her conclusions are before you, and she's here to answer any questions that you may have, members. And then finally, something that came out of discussion with the complainants is that the council's whistleblower policy is, like most organisations, designed around the Public Interest Disclosure Act, i.e. the protections that should be given to employees when they blow a whistle on an organisation of which they're part and feel there is wrongdoing. That's extended in an organisation like this, for obvious reasons, to contractors, given that so much of what we do is contracted out. But there isn't anything in there about one of the points that the complainants made, which is that they followed a process which was to blow the whistle on what they felt was, at the time, fraudulent behaviour. We might call it the misspending of public money. Which then led to them being victimised and being subject to counter-allegations. And where's the role and duty of the council that when somebody has allegations made against them in the public sphere in relation to something to do with the council, be that grant funding or anything else, and they, in the council's view, are subjected to false and malicious allegations, where's the council's role in saying that out loud and protecting those people from the effects of those allegations? Now, that's not currently in your procedures, that's not within your policy, and it is an undertaking that we gave as officers to put that before you. And you may wish to discuss that today and make any recommendations to the audit committee for when they do their review of the whistleblower policy to include such an element. Chair, Mrs. Shaw and I are here to answer any questions you
may have. I'm going to open this up at this moment, at this very moment in time, for questions to the officers from the committee members. What do you want to ask either Phil or the
question? If I can, Chair, just clarity from Mr. McCaws. From what you were saying regarding the apology from Councillor Louise Rhys Jones was sent to you to then forward on to the whistleblowers, and the apology, from what I can gather, what you just said, was to apologise for breaching the code from my recollection of the notes I got from the standards.
Ah.
The apology was to be issued to the whistleblowers, not to apologise for breaching the code, because it is quite a part of it. That's what they requested to do.
Chair, that's my understanding of the panel decision, which was your requirement that Councillor Rees-Jones apologise to those people who were subjected to her actions. What we had on the 18th of October was an email to me that stated enclosed are the three apologies as per the standards panel of 15th June 2017. Please also send me details of training and organise for me to attend. And as you've seen, those are one sentence. One sentence letters to the named individuals without an address, and therefore a presumption that I was to send them on because having checked with the complainants, they have certainly received them.
Okay, well, that doesn't mean we find the complainants have not received the apology.
No, and I think Councillor Bertie, that might be something that when we're looking at the recommendations from this committee tonight, we might want to elaborate on what we mean by an apology, because everybody needs to understand what we expect to follow. Does anybody else want to ask a question? Councillor Gilchrist.
In the paperwork we've got today, the decision of the standards panel is reported. There are five pages of that, and on page 15, as Councillor Blakely was inquiring, section B clearly said that Councillor Rees-Jones must apologise in writing to all the complainants. When we met to discuss these issues, standards panel, we spent some time working through the reports and hearing evidence, and the standards notice was written after we'd heard the evidence, and as members of the panel, we checked the standards notice before Mr. Tour was asked to send it out. So my view, the standards notice was quite clear in requiring a apology in writing to all the complainants. On the night of the panel, a number of members of the public and other complainants were present. We did meet in private because I was concerned about the pressure and the strain on the complainants. We met in private to hear things expressed to us courteously and frankly, which I believe we do. So in reaching clause B of our sanctions, it was quite clear what our intention was as a panel.
Thank you. Anybody else want to ask a question? Yes, Councillor Kenny.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I think Mr. McCall said a few minutes ago that Councillor Louise Rees-Jones asked you for guidance, I think it was last Friday, as to what she needed to say in her apology. I think you clarified that it's up to the meeting this afternoon to decide that. Do you have a recommendation or a form of words to put to the meeting this afternoon, or are you just happy to leave it up to the meeting?
If you don't mind, Councillor Kenny, I'll be on putting recommendations to the committee and forms of words for rather than Mr. McCall, if that's okay. Just want to ask a question. Councillor Gilchrist.
Does the bundle of papers is so expensive and requires all the original panel evidence?
Save it to the microphone.
Sorry, Chair. The pages 197 onwards are Mickey Shaw's report. I wonder whether Mr. Shaw would want to elaborate on anything based on what's been said so far during the
week. I'm sure Mr. Shaw would like to elaborate on some of the contents of her report. Is there anything particular that members would like me to? I mean, the points that come out to me are the original statements that were made by the independent investigator around credibility and lack of credibility and inconsistent information that was given by Councillor Louise Rees-Jones in contrast with consistent and credible information that was given by the complainants. But further, the lack of cooperation that was brought to our attention by the independent investigator, which resulted in us referring him for a further investigation. So perhaps around that, you could elaborate.
Yes, I think you can see that my conclusions, I think, essentially were summarised in Mr. McCall's report, and again, in relation to the further complaints that came in after the standards panel, I basically upheld that as a breach of the code of conduct. and in relation to reviewing issues that have been raised by Alison Morton, which the panel had asked for a further review of. Again, you see that my conclusion was that I was forced to conclude that Councillor Rees-James again failed to show respect to the standards process and maintain the high standards of conduct as a councillor. Obviously, some of the information that we went through was the same information that had already been considered by the original investigator, and I didn't want to visit all of that information again in my report, but I've tried to summarise my views having reviewed that and carried out a further interview with both the complainants and the Councillor Rees-James.
Thank you.
Are we all right to move on to the next part of the meeting? We're happy with the what we've heard so far. The next part of the meeting is at the point at which I ask, first of all, the individual complainants if they would like to make a brief statement to the panel, and after that I will ask Councillor Rees-James if she would like to make a brief statement to the committee. Do any of the complainants want to come forward? If you would you kindly, if you don't mind sitting in the chair, there's a microphone there, somebody will show you how to use it. And if you could give us your name, if you don't mind, and just make a brief statement. Your names.
Week in public forums on the local news thread, associates of the council Mr. Johnson, the right job that we colluded, and all that we've done wrong. We have all the screenshots of all of this. We can't stop this now. Without your help, we cannot stop this, because it's one of those bells that you can't unring. These people never believe it, and there's certain people who will never believe the truth. We need some help to finally bring this to a stop.
The difficulty is as well, because it's out there in the public forum, it's just our head.
I think we've understood what you're telling us, and thank you for making your contribution. Are there any other complainants want to make a statement?
Sorry, I'm not a complainant, but
I'm going to take the complaints. Could you tell me who you are, please?
Yes, I'm their legal counsel, so I'm here. I'm not going to say anything. I'm just making you aware that I am here today.
Okay.
And I'm their legal representative.
Okay. Thank you for that. So I ask again, are there any other complainants who would like to make a brief statement? Yes, would you like to come forward and sit in the chair? And somebody will show you how to use the microphone. And if you just tell us who you are, and that would be helpful. Just press the
red. My name is Jean Robbins, and I'm from the chair of the Church of Men's Association. We just want to see, what the panel's decision is. Anything I'd like to say is that we have not received an apology and fortune from Councillor Rhys Jones since the Sanders panel they appealed. So I'd just like to say that we're very disappointed that hasn't happened. We didn't receive one nice for the meeting, and there was an apology given to the compliance. But just to reiterate that we've not received one as at tonight's meeting, we haven't received an apology.
Okay, thank you.
Are we right to move on? Councillor Rees would like to come forward and if you want to make a brief statement, please. Chair, I've separated my two statements out into the standards panel of the 15th of
we're running the standards panel, Councillor Jones, Ms. Jones. We are merely looking for a statement from you tonight, but we're not rerunning that hearing.
So I would just the
decision of the panel on the 15th of June, the sanctions that were applied, and how you complied with those, and the further allegations that you don't have, not the panel hearing on the 15th of June.
So I'm asking the other person, please.
Well, I think at the start of the meeting, she indicated that the person was going to help her understand what's happening. But are we clear about what your statement is about? It's tonight, about what's happening tonight, not about the panel hearing on the 15th of June and the sanctions. It's whether or not you've complied with the sanctions. If not, why not? And then we'll move on from there.
I think it would be helpful for all the people who just know the gentleman is and his
capacity. Okay, for the sake of the records, could you give us your name and tell us what your actual credentials are for being here?
My name is Michael Chard. Louise has asked me to attend with her because you know she has hearing difficulties. And I must say, one of the issues I've had, and I'm not deaf, is that I've been unable to hear much of what's been said because unfortunately the microphones have not been turned on. Madam Chairman, you turned your microphone on at the end of all the submissions. So unfortunately, the two complainants came here and they didn't turn the microphones on. So one of the problems I've had.
Can I just stop you there? Because all I asked you for, if you don't mind, was your name and your credentials.
Yes.
I used my microphone appropriately, and the complainants used their microphones as well. Okay. I was very clear that I saw the lights come on when they used their microphones. I'm sorry if you didn't hear. I also asked Councillor Louise Rees-Jones at the start of the meeting if she was comfortable with the arrangements that were in place. If she isn't, then we can adjourn and resume at 6 o'clock when the signs are here. But we've got your name now. Thank you.
Can I just finish? Because you want Louise Rees-Jones to say and put her statement forward, and you said something there, and right at the end of the you said, sorry, I put my microphone on.
Okay, let me be very, very clear what I am saying. Yes. At the start of her council's statement,
yes.
What I'm looking for
yes.
is not submissions that were made on the 15th of June.
Yes.
We are not looking to rerun that. We are looking only for her observations and her statements which relate to the sanctions that were applied in as set out in the decision letter, how she's complied with those, and what's happened since. So any statement around the 15th of June hearing that is not going to be acceptable tonight. It is purely about what's happened since, whether you've complied with the sanctions, if not, why not, and what's happened since. Clear?
Okay. Can I finish what I'm saying, which is that the reason why I'm here is to assist Councillor Louise Jones, because she has a hearing disability. And the fact of the matter is that much of the conversation that's taken place tonight, we were unable to hear, as that gentleman at the back said, and at the end, what you said was, sorry, my microphone is not on, and you then put the microphone on. Okay, so, I honestly didn't hear it.
I'm going to ask once more. Yes. Councillor Louise Drews-Jones, are you comfortable with the arrangements that you have in place for you to follow what is happening? Because the indication I'm getting from the person with you is that you are not. So can you clarify the question I asked you at the start? Were you comfortable with the arrangements that are in place for you? You said you were. Can you confirm that you are still comfortable with the arrangements that are in place? Or do you want us to adjourn and come back at 6 o'clock?
I'm happy to continue.
Okay, so we'll move on. Are you clear about what the statement will relate to that you're going to give us now? Okay,
so what I was going to say was, I've broken it down into two. First is the standards panel and the outcomes of the standards panel, and the second is the 11th of July complaints, further complaints, and I've done them both separate. So if I address the standards panel first, I understand that tonight is around the outcomes of the standards panel, and I'd like the following to be taken into account by the panel. I've issued apologies to all complainants as directed by the standards panel decision, and that was the written decision. This followed verbal apologies of two of the complainants on the 15th of July and detailed in the decision communicated on the 15th of July. On page 5 of the sanction, section B, I was asked to apologise to all complainants for breaching the code of conduct. I have done this. The monitoring officer has asked me in writing that it is perceived that the apology is not within the spirit of the standards decision. If this aspect of the decision is not seen as being met, then please advise me what is lacking in my apology, as it follows precisely the wording of the standards panel decision. Secondly, the training. The recommendation of the panel was that the monitoring officer arranges training both internally and externally. This has not been completed to date, and the monitoring officer feels the training should follow the apology to being accepted by the committee, regardless of me asking for it. The further complaints of the 11th of July, caused by an alleged screenshot from my personal locked Facebook account, I have supplied screenshots of my actual post, explaining why the alleged post could not possibly be from my account to the Deputy Director of Law and Governance. From a recent meeting I had with Vicky Shaw, the investigator appointed to discuss the further complaints, I assumed that I would have the opportunity to review any findings prior to it being referred to the standards panel. Additional evidence is enclosed, so I have a pack of additional evidence that can be submitted. All these documents can be viewed and verified live on account. So it's not just, these are not just screenshots, you are very welcome to see them. I have 14 appendices. I've asked for my email and screenshots of the 11th of July that were sent in by three further complainants before the appeal time was up. These three complaints came in. So my appeal, I wasn't in within the apology. I appealed, and then the appeal time wasn't up before these complaints came in. The screenshot I've asked to be sent to Merseyside Police. I know it would be fraudulent, and therefore it's only right and proper that Rural Council refer this to Merseyside Police. I did report it to Merseyside Police under crime reference number 051718830. Merseyside Police informed me they could only receive the documents from Rural Council as it was sent to them. The monitoring officer has to date not informed Merseyside Police. This entire case has been about fraudulent documents. I would welcome the review of this entire process under scrutiny. This would include having access to all submitted documents and evidence. I have never and would never seek to deceive or discredit another person. World Standards Committee have published unfounded accusations into the public domain based on the primary findings of World Council officers, not the findings of Merseyside Police Fraud Squad after an extensive evidence-based investigation. This has led to catastrophic reputational damage to my family and myself. I have faced almost 1 year suspended from the Labour Party and now a further four months with the whip removed. I have not been charged with any offence. I face online trolls and I've had a death threat as a result of this process. My private life has suffered and my work has been majorly affected by the documents that were published. My university studies have been affected and I've had to consider my future. Further to the submission of Mr. McCourt, I'd just like to clarify the dates that I received the appeal notice that my appeal had not been, I wasn't allowed to appeal, was done in July, it was done on July the 26th. On July the 28th, I was then sent a further complaint. The complaint was in relation to me not adhering, and I don't know if you've got a copy of that complaint, but I have within here. The complaint was then a further complaint, and it was felt, and I was advised, that actually, until it was all dealt with, an apology shouldn't be given, given the ferocity of a screenshot being sent in, which I know to be fraudulent. My Facebook is locked, and I have a copy of all the appendices that I put within this, which I'm happy to share with the committee. It shows, and has been scrutinised by Merseyside Police, it shows that the Facebook post that was sent in of the screenshot of the 11th of July is not a screenshot from my Facebook post, nor could it be possible that it is a screenshot of my Facebook post. As this entire investigation is about fraudulent documents and recreation of documents, I think it's extremely relevant.
Thank you very much. We'd like to take a seat back in the evening podium.
Just for clarification, because I didn't think it relevant to you tonight, that Councillor Elise Jones is correct in that she did send me a number of screenshots. She has asked me on several occasions to report it to the police, and indeed has said it's my duty to report it to the police. My response was, it's not an alleged crime made against this council. It's not something that you corporately have suffered. It's a matter between entirely for Councillor Elise Jones, but if she wants to report something to the police, she can. I don't consider it within the council's role, or indeed my duty to do so. That's my opinion, and I thought it worth just saying that those events did happen, as Councillor Elise Jones stated, and she now wishes to respond.
Can I just very briefly, because this I'm not going to allow.
Just in response to that, so I did report it to Merseyside Police, and Merseyside Police said, because I had not received the screenshot sent to me directly, it had to come from the council, because I had no information where it came from or how it got there.
We've took the advice of the Director of Law, and you've given us the over account of what's happened, and thank you very much. We've noted that.
Information, Chair, I quite agree. It's just to say that I have made it clear that if Merseyside Police at any point contact us, we will of course fully cooperate with them in anything they wish to have their part.
Okay, thank you. Would you like to take seat? Right, I'm going to open it up at this point to the committee to discuss what we've heard, what you've seen, the significant amount of information you've got in your packs. I think probably the person who's best placed to start this discussion will be Councillor Gilchrist, if you want to, as you chaired the panel on the 15th of June. Then I'll ask Councillor Blakely and myself, and then if anybody else would like to make a comment on what we've had before us tonight, we'll be happy to do that, and then we'll draw some conclusions
briefly, Chair. The panel had the benefit of the attendance of an independent person who carried out interviews and sought to establish the facts. I haven't heard anything new that says the independent person wasn't thorough. We got the impression throughout that opportunities have been given for Councillor Louise Jones to question the findings of that independent person and disagree with them. But I think on the night we gave opportunities for that to be done.
Councillor Blakely. Thank you, Chair. That'll be a previous cameras as well. Councillor Louise Jones said tonight the entire case was based on fraudulent documents. I don't believe that to be the case, I think there's other things other than that. She also stated quite clearly she was not allowed to appeal. She was allowed to appeal. Mr. Tor at the time did not believe that appeal provided any new relevant information to justify that appeal. So she has to accept she was allowed to appeal. The fact is, she didn't provide any new evidence. And as Bill said, you know, we have the benefit of the independent investigator, and we can read through the reports. The opportunities have been given to Councillor Louise Rees Jones to both make personal and written representations have been there all along, all the way through. She has failed to make those or take those opportunities, and as we found out on the night of the appeal panel, she clearly did not wish to cooperate in any more concerns to it. And I think that's continued tonight.
Thank you very much. And I'm the third member of the panel, and I first would like to say that the findings of the panel and the sanctions that were agreed were unanimous. We all agreed that the sanctions were the maximum that we could impose on someone, and that reflected the seriousness with which we regarded what we heard. As a Labour member of the panel, it was very difficult for me to hear that a Labour councillor had used her position as a councillor to damage the reputation and the livelihoods of other people. Without saying that people who come into this council were elected to serve the residents of the borough and not to use our position to do damage to them. And I'm afraid, from what we've seen and what we've read and what we've heard again, Councillor Louise Rees Jones continues to do that, to use that position. I have to say, it's almost beyond belief that 4 months after we asked for an apology, which we will elaborate on, I think, towards the end of this, on what we mean by apology, what should be an apology, but that apology still has not been given. And the whole point of an apology is that there is an acknowledgement that some wrongdoing has taken place, and there is an undertaking that it won't happen again. And that is what we haven't had, and that is what we're looking for here. But I'm happy to hear from anybody else on the committee who might want to make. Yes, Councillor Hayes.
Thank you, Chair. Someone fairly new to this isn't what's involved in the initial hearing, but I share your disbelief, really, Chair, as to what I've heard so far and what I've read in the pack. And on the point of the letter specifically, I'm quite frankly astounded that an elected member of this council doesn't know how to write a proper, full, unreserved letter of apology. I mean, what more does she want? She says she wants guidance. But if we write the letter for her, surely that affects the sincerity of the letter as well. It really is astounding that she comes here tonight and asks us for further guidance on that.
Yes.
As you well know, Chair, I was present at that meeting and I was extremely impressed by the manner in which the whole business was conducted. It was extensive, it was fair, and everyone had the opportunity to say exactly what they wished at that time. And I am surprised that we're back here some 4 months later, as